morning, everyone, and welcome to day 4 of our celebration week. My name is Vicky Scott and I'll be your presenter today. Following on from yesterday's fantastic presentations from adult social care, inclusion, one consultation, forensics and arts for health, as well as some inspiring patient stories, we have another action-packed day ahead. Today's celebrations will focus on carer and family engagement. We're going to start off with a presentation on our carer engagement project from Fiona Moore.
Carer and family engagement is an extremely important priority for our trust. The Carers Trust defines a carer as anyone who cares, unpaid, for a friend or family member who, due to illness, disability, a mental health problem, or an addiction, cannot cope without their support. If someone is involved with and gives significant support to another person, irrespective of whether they live with that person or not, they should be considered to be a carer and be actively engaged by the care team. We are signed up to the Triangle of Care, which is the therapeutic alliance between service users, staff and carers. There are 6 standards for the Triangle of Care. Standard 1 is around carers and the essential role they play and making sure they're identified at first contact or as soon as possible thereafter. Standard 2, staff are carer aware and trained in carer engagement strategies. Standard 3, policy and practice protocols regarding confidentiality and sharing information are in place. Standard 4, defined posts are responsible for carers are in place. Standard 5, a carer introduction to the service and staff is available with a relevant range of information across the care pathway. And Standard 6, a range of carer support services are available. We're doing this now because in 2018, the Triangle of Care assessments identified that we needed to improve in terms of offering our staff carer awareness training. Our involvement and experience strategy defines one of our priorities around improving the experience for our carers and families. We undertook a review of feedback from our service user and carer surveys and PALS concerns, where people were telling us that they felt not involved in decisions about care, treatment and support. The NHS long-term plan defines that we need to have greater recognition and support, identify carers, particularly from vulnerable communities, and have carer support during times of emergency and support for young carers. And also NICE guidance recently produced in January 2020, supporting adult carers. So far, we set up a carer engagement steering group and carried out 4 engaging with carers workshops for staff during October and November. Since then, we've been collating that feedback and we've now designed a training package that's due to be rolled out in October 2020. So what should a carer get from interactions with staff? Acknowledgement of their relevance and make sure that they feel valued. Support to maintain their own mental health and physical health. No assumptions. Interaction should be person-centred, irrespective of circumstances. Give a carer permission to have their own life and interests. Engagement with third sector or statutory agencies that specialise with carers' issues, including access to a carer's assessment. A lifeline, accessible trust contact details is all it takes. Someone they can talk honestly and confidentially to without fear of being judged. So what could this look like in the future? It's important to us as an organisation for carers, families and friends to feel valued, recognised and involved as equal partners in the care of a person and in service delivery and planning. It's also important that we listen to and communicate effectively with carers, family and friends, and that we provide support to carers to maintain their own well-being. So how can we support staff to engage effectively? All clinical staff should receive carer awareness training. Clinical supervision should address carer engagement and awareness. All trusts should identify staff who are carer leads and who support staff and input into awareness training. And a carer engagement forum should be in place to consider ongoing awareness and engagement issues. So in summary, we should be able to provide information, support and advice in a considered manner, involve carers in all stages of the process, including assessment, care planning, treatment, referrals and discharge planning, aftercare provision, signposting to housing and employment support. An effective triangle of care will only be complete if there is a willingness by the professional and carer to engage. Carers wish to be trusted, involved and become more effective. Services may have traditional ways of doing things which create obstacles for carer support. Carer engagement training will be rolled out across the organisation from October, so please encourage your teams to book onto this training and we're happy to support.
Thank you very much for that, Fiona. Next, we'd like to hand over to Nikki Evans and Laura Campbell at the Keele Impact Accelerator Unit.
First became interested in people taking some responsibility for their own health when I was living and working overseas, where there was little access to good medical care. Of course, to be able to take some responsibility, you need good information. When I returned to the UK, I joined our local GP practice patient participation group, helping the Impact Accelerator Unit to implement research knowledge into clinical practice is very satisfying. The patient benefits by perhaps getting better health care in a shorter time scale. More generally, it means that the funds that are spent on research see positive results sooner.
It's a real privilege to be a member of Keele University's Link Group. The Link Group gives me the opportunity to meet with other patients like myself who are as passionate as I am about making sure that research evidence is translated into practice as quickly as possible. Our meetings are always fun and I really enjoy bouncing ideas off other members of the group, and it's expertly facilitated by Laura and the team.
I didn't really want to speak, but I quickly became enthusiastic. I learned topics and understanding of a vast, wide range of things I didn't know about. I became more interested in being able to speak myself. But today, now, a few years on from joining the group, I've learned a huge amount. I really have. I've developed as a person. I participate in various topics with interest and I've supported the group wholeheartedly.
The inspiration and success of the group is that as patients we are given the freedom to be proactive rather than reactive in research projects. Acting as a bridge between users and providers and using our expertise by experience to provide a layperson perspective for the Impact Accelerator Unit to successfully implement innovations.
As with many nurses, I had a variety of interesting and challenging jobs and feel so very privileged in having done so. This inspired me to join Link, together with the fact of meeting a lovely group of people from different backgrounds and the opportunity of being involved in a small way in the wheel of research. We are one of the ways of which researchers connect to patients. Our experience enables us to make that connection as good as it can be, so that patients are helped to benefit from the work that goes on in research.
I was working as a volunteer at the Hayward Hospital, and my manager suggested that this may be something that I would like to do. I quickly took up the offer. Since joining the group, I have learned so much and have enjoyed sharing knowledge and mutual respect with my fellow members. I think we make a great team. We get things done and we move important issues forward. It has made a huge difference to how I feel about research and how public participation can be a valuable link to improved healthcare.
I've had rheumatoid arthritis for over 15 years now, and it's really important for me to know that there's research being done to improve the care that I receive. I've spent a lot of time looking into different ways I can improve my condition, and any time I spend, I want to make sure it's done in the right way using the latest evidence.
Having service users and carers in the mix, I am sure, has helped develop a mutual understanding of what can be achieved by involving a wide range of professionals and people with lived experiences all around the same table simultaneously.
Researchers have a duty to share a new knowledge with a wider audience, including the general public, in order to improve the relevance of their findings. Therefore, getting research findings into healthcare practice is something that should be thought about from the very beginning of the project. The Link Group has increasingly been asked to compile routes to implementation and dissemination of research findings. We therefore prepared a document entitled A Dissemination Toolkit for Knowledge Mobilisation and Promotion of Innovation, which supports researchers, research students and project coordinators in the transfer of evidence-based findings into everyday healthcare practice.
And I never thought I would ever see such a diverse group of people working together, and we all listen to each other and we all are very enthusiastic on the topics for change, and with that actually we always respect each other's views. And we all want the health decisions to be taken seriously and the patient voice being heard.
When coronavirus hit the UK, everything changed. Everybody had to adapt very quickly to a new way of life. But I was once again privileged to be asked by the IAU to contribute to the rapid development of a guide to help people coping with musculoskeletal pain during the COVID-19 outbreak. Working closely with physiotherapists, GPs, dietitians and other patients, a top tips guide on how to stay active and keep well during lockdown was produced. Inevitably, one major factor impacting on the development and production of this invaluable guide was the need for the team to meet and communicate in the virtual world of video calls and meetings. But the guide itself needed to be interesting and relevant. As a lay contributor who was also shielding at the height of the outbreak, I was able to suggest ideas and tips to help others manage their own physical and mental health and well-being. Another important factor for me at the time, apart from contributing to the top tips, was how much the Impact Accelerator unit continued to involve and engage lay people in many projects and studies through the Research User Group and the Link Group. COVID has turned the world upside down and inside out, but my involvement with the IAU at Keele and the musculoskeletal team at the Hayward Hospital has continued almost unhindered.
We found out during the lockdown that people are all too willing to spread knowledge about healthcare issues. Some of that knowledge is inaccurate, to say the least. We can't meet with the groups we normally meet with. We can't run displays in GP practice waiting rooms, but we can use other avenues of communication.
Bye.
Following on from Fiona's presentation earlier today around carer engagement, I'd like to tell you a bit more about the background to the project. Specifically, Triangle of Care has enabled us to provide a baseline assessment which shows to what extent individual teams are meeting the six standards, which are as follows. Standard 1, carer role. Standard 2, staff training. Standard 3, confidentiality. Standard 4, carer leads. Standard 5, information. Standard 6, support for carers. The six standards provide a way for teams to benchmark themselves, demonstrate examples of good practice, as well as identify areas for improvement. Areas of good practice that were identified in the latest report included carers' views being respected, encouraging carers to share information, carers' support services being available, and access to one-to-one support for carers. This was really positive as it showed that teams involved in the assessment were focusing on communicating effectively and sharing information wherever possible. The improvements identified in this report were around the need for carer awareness training, and as Fiona has already discussed, work is well underway to deliver this where required. The following recommendations were also made as a result of the report findings, and they included the need to produce welcome packs, identifying carer champions, and the need to highlight the importance of accurate record keeping throughout the trust. Work with the teams involved in the assessment continues, and we very much look forward to sharing this with teams across the trust. And now here's a presentation around engagement and research from the Children's Diabetes Services.
My name's Carol, I'm family support with the Children and Young Persons Diabetes team at Hanford. As part of my role, I provide a parent group which gives parents the opportunity to meet together, to share experiences and concerns. It also flags up, it can also flag up, extra needs or concerns that parents may have. When this happens, we'll put sessions on to help to resolve some of the issues. For example, we've done carb counting sessions where I bring other members of my team in, dietitians and nurses. As well as the carb counting sessions, we've done sick day rules. Information is always provided by the healthcare professionals that I work with. I think the groups help parents to feel less isolated about the situation, that they're not on their own. Because sometimes you can feel that this is it and nobody else suffers the same. As well as that, I provide coffee mornings where we meet up for a general chat. The coffee mornings are spread in various locations so that all parents can access the coffee mornings if they want to. We have craft days where we get together and parents will share their different crafts and hobbies that they prefer. This also is a bit of a distraction that takes you a bit away from the diabetes care that is a 24/7 rule. I have been told by parents in the past that the sessions that we put on for carb counting or diabetes management and things is they learn more because it's a more relaxed atmosphere and it's things that they specifically asked for. So yeah. During the school holidays, we'll meet up again, but this time with the children, and we've been to places like Flip Out or tubing. Sometimes we'll meet up and we'll all have a meal together, and that one again shows the kids that they're not on their own, that the other children are in the group. They have to give insulin and test blood sugars before they eat and various things. I'm hoping that I think it gives people the opportunity outside of the diabetes care, just time to get together and socialise. All the sessions that I do, I ask what parents want, so as it meets their needs. And I also do evaluation sheets. If something doesn't work or somebody doesn't like something, then hopefully we'll change it and it suits everybody's needs. The sessions also help to provide service need, what the parents or patients need, so we can cater our service within the team to suit individual needs and wants. during the current climate that we're in, and because of social distancing, we've recently been meeting up on Zoom once a week. This again gives the opportunity for parents to meet up together. It shows that they're not actually on their own and they're not the only persons. I'm hoping that it makes them feel less isolated. And then they'll also meet up in their own Zoom groups, which is just a carry on from what I provide. Once again, it gives parents the opportunity, as well as our patients, the time to get together, because we do have the young people on Zoom as well, which can be fun, if not hectic.
Thanks for that. And here's Fiona with a presentation on In Our Gift.
In Our Gift is an interactive community where you can share great ideas, ones that have been implemented and changes that you would like to make or see happen. Not only can we share ideas, we can learn from other people about what they're doing. There are 3 organisational challenges and a gift box. Since launch on the 3rd of August, there have been over 1,100 users who've logged on to the hub, over 14,500 post and page views, over 3,250 votes on ideas, and 228 ideas posted. The challenges are around agile working, improving service user and carer experience, improving our experience and well-being at work, and the gift box for everything else. Our challenge is around improving service user and carer experience. 30 ideas, 340 votes, and 198 comments have been added to our service user and carer challenge. 11 of these are under discussion, 4 in development, 14 where collaboration is happening, and 1 MPFT change. A member of staff placed an idea on In Our Gift around face coverings and communication, which was around being able to engage with service users who might have hearing difficulties while staff are using PPE equipment with the use of Google Live Transcribe. This has now been deployed to all staff mobile phones. Our challenge asks for your ideas on improving the experience of our service users and carers, so please get involved by liking ideas, adding comments, and voting on your favourite ideas. You'll earn points on all interactions, so please visit the In Our Gift site and get sharing.
Thanks for that, Fiona. And now here's for some really interesting insight into the work of the Arts for Wellbeing project.
Okay, so we just wanted to share a bit of information about the Arts for Wellbeing programme, which is run by the Occupational Therapy Department amongst the Community Learning Disabilities team. So we wanted to tell you a bit about what we've been up to and why we're doing it. So Shelley,
yes.
Could you share some information about your art projects?
Yeah. We did the desert island one, and then you've got to think what can you take with you.
Brilliant. And those were all of your favourite things, weren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah, and things that make you happy. Brilliant. And Naomi, can you share something? Hold it up to the camera. Lovely, that's great. So over the last 9-10 weeks, we've all been working on lots of different projects that can help us feel happy and well, and using art as that medium to do that. Shelley, what else have we been doing alongside the art?
We've been doing the mask, self-portrait, The river, but I'm having trouble pronouncing it.
That's okay.
Done some more rivers. The hand one.
Lovely.
And also we did the random acts of kindness.
Lovely, that's great. We did, didn't we? Where we thought about how we can be kind to ourselves and how we can be kind to other people as well. What do we normally do in the session before we start our art?
The emotion chart.
We do the emotion chart. So we have a check-in with each other, don't we? How we're feeling that day. And what do we do next?
Relaxation and meditation.
That's right. Yeah, we do, don't we? So we have a relaxation, a visualization, or a meditation session prior to our art group. So for those watching this video, would you recommend this group to them?
I would, yes.
Lovely. And would you, Naomi?
Yeah.
Lovely. Okay, well, thanks for your time, ladies. Okay, so there we've just heard some of the ladies with learning disabilities that attended the Arts for Wellbeing programme. Obviously, during these difficult and challenging times that we've experienced this year, adjustments have had to have been made. So the group was facilitated via Microsoft Teams. And the way in which the ladies have adapted their routines, they've adapted to the use of this technology in order to engage with each other and with the Community Learner Disabilities team has been amazing. They've been able to foster a very supportive and safe environment for each other to explore some of their challenges and explore their personal experiences and then use art as that therapeutic medium to further express themselves. Obviously, COVID has brought a lot of change to people's routine, and significantly so for people with learning disabilities. The ladies have produced the artwork. We are currently looking at putting on a MPFT, additional page on the MPFT online web page to showcase some of their artwork, and they hope to inspire others, especially those with learning disabilities, to use art as a therapeutic medium and continue to engage in occupations and activities that they're able to do so despite this being such a difficult and changing time for everybody.
Thanks for that. It was really interesting and it was great to see some work which these service users are doing. I really enjoyed that presentation. And now it's time for a talk from Sue and Joe at Forensics, and they're going to tell us about the Forensic Carers Toolkit. So over to you guys. Thank you.
My name's Joe Probin, everyone, and I am one of the carers leads that works in Forensics, part of the Trust. We're going to be talking today about the Carers Toolkit. I'd just like to introduce Sue, who is a forensic carer.
Hello, everybody.
Okay, Sue, I've got some questions about the toolkit. Question number one, what are the benefits?
Right, the toolkit came about because of a lack of information for forensic carers in particular. A lot of general information is given out for carers, but not specifically for forensic carers. And I think there are three main needs that forensic carers have. They have their own needs as carers around information and support. They want to be involved in the care of their loved one, and they want to be involved in service development, training and improvement so others can benefit. And hopefully this toolkit enables a lot of that information to come together in one place.
That's great. Thanks, Sue. What do you think is the most important information to be got from the toolkit?
I think the most important thing about the toolkit is that a lot of information is in one place. So whatever information that carer needs at that point in their journey, they should find it within the toolkit. It was designed so both carers and staff could dip in and out and look at the information they need at any point in the journey and be informed in a way that was easy to understand and perhaps took away some of the mystique that some of the phrases and words used create when dealing with forensic services. So hopefully it's an easy toolkit to navigate and to find the right information in.
Okay, that's really helpful. Is there anything else you'd like to say about what could be useful?
I think if people view the toolkits online, they will find there are a couple of very short films within it. And it's useful sometimes to remind staff in particular about what a forensic carer has normally gone through with their loved one leading up to the loved one's admission to secure services. And the first film embedded in the toolkit shows a bit of that journey from the forensic carer's point of view, and I think needs to be sometimes highlighted in order to probably describe in a way the needs and the concerns that a forensic carer will have in dealing with services and their loved one's pathway as they move through different treatments.
Great, thank you. I've just picked up a couple of points there, that this forensic carers toolkit's not just for carers, it's equally important for staff to have read and had a look at it as well. And I know we've certainly sent it round to every staff member, but if there are any staff members listening, it would be really, really worth your while to look at. I'm sure you can confirm, Sue, that it's very straightforward.
Yes, it is. There's easy headings and chapters within the toolkit. There's also reference to some of the research that was done to integrate information into the toolkit. There's a glossary of terms at the end of it, so people who are unfamiliar with dealing with forensic services can familiarise themselves with different phrases. But as I say, it also was done with the aim of helping professionals to understand the journey that a forensic carer has been on, continues to be on, and sometimes their needs that can be overlooked along the way when there are changes to the loved one's care.
That's great, thank you. Have you got any other comments or anything else you'd like to say, Sue?
No, just to encourage people to have a look at this, either in paper form or online. I think they will find it very interesting if they don't know anything about a forensic carer and they're liable to come across them in their work, but don't meet many and wouldn't like to ask an individual about their experiences. But also for forensic carers, to give them the confidence that if they want to raise an issue or they want to challenge something within the service, that they know the right way to do it.
Thank you. That's great.
Thanks to Sue and Joe for a really interesting insight into the work in forensics at the moment. So now it's over to Patricia Callaghan for something completely different. She's going to read a poem to us, which is entitled The Warm Dust of Childhood. So sit back and enjoy.
The warm dust of childhood. The humming of the kiln, the moulding of the clay, the roughness of the biscuitware, the stuff of every day. A city grey and filled with noise, my childhood memory, of working days and pot banks and china cups for tea. Everywhere a warm and chalky breeze would fill the air, infusing all the senses with the smell of earthenware. The hot dust of production hung leaden in the sky, while deep inside the factory the fettling fingers fly. Grinning faces, smoking fags, went about their day, flushed from fiery furnaces, lit to bake the clay. I wandered through the workshops when not attending school, unhindered by the absence of the health and safety rule. Rows of wooden benches, housing rows of toiling faces, nimble-fingered painters put brushes through their paces. noses to the grindstone, working fingers to the bone, grafting for a weekly wage spent paying off the loan. Generations of my family were employed within the trade. Every cup and saucer used, we knew where it was made. Dusty faces, well-worn hands, the potter's uniform. Times were tough, the days were long, but hearts were kind and warm. Salt of the earth, the five townsfolk, I celebrate their worth and thank them for the memories that made my place of birth. So when you drink your coffee or gently sip your tea, take a moment to reflect and fondly think of me, a childhood spent in clay and dust and crafting crockery of potter's wheels and porcelain, my childhood memory. The humming of the kiln, the moulding of the clay, the roughness of the biscuitware, the stuff of every day.
Thank you for that heartwarming poem, Patricia. Really enjoyed it. It really evoked a sense of what life was like for those growing up in the pottery industry. It was really good. Now we're going to hear from the Special Needs Continence team in Staffordshire.
Hi, I'm Pam.
And I'm Kate.
And we are the Staffordshire Special Needs School Nursing Service.
We have a team of 25 staff that includes special needs school nurses, healthcare support workers and an administrator called Gemma.
We cover 24 special schools across the county of Staffordshire, providing support for children, young people and their families.
During the COVID lockdown period, this support has continued to those children who've attended school throughout and also virtually to children and families who've been at home.
And this is our journey.
Hi, I'm Amber.
And I'm Sarah, with the new Special Needs Outreach and Continence Support Team for Staffordshire, put in post to support the Special Needs School Nurses Team and to work alongside the Specialist Pelvic Healthcare Team. We just came into post in February and we're just establishing our new role when the lockdown began. We've had fun adapting our role to these changing times to offer ongoing support to the children and young people in our care.
During these testing times, we've offered many telephone consultations and assessment and had regular contact with our families. We've offered support for toilet training, not toileteries, and we've done social distance home visits, dropping off equipment and information.
We are excited to continue to develop and adapt our service and have some great ideas for the future.
Thank you.
Hello, my name's Jackie. I am the parent of a 17-year-old boy called Elliot who attends special school. This is our story with regards to the present pandemic. On the 19th of December 2019, our world was pulled apart by the sudden death of my husband and Elliot's dad. We got through the Christmas period somehow. Elliot went back to school in the January. Come the end of March time, middle of March, when COVID-19 lockdown occurred, Elliot initially could stop at school as I was a key worker. However, he found the changes to both peers, staff and the school environment very hard to cope with, so I decided to keep him off. Lucky for me, the organisation I work for decided to furlough me and we remained at home. Over the next few weeks, Elliot's behaviour, both verbally and physically, got worse. And he also started to wee the bed and refused to go out of the house. He was very scared of what he called the bug. After phoning our GP for support, they suggested the school nurse may be able to help. So I contacted Jo, the school nurse, who was fantastic. She listened to my woes and I managed to offload some of my emotional problems on her. During our conversations, she said she would look into further services that Elliot and I could access. Within a matter of a few days, we heard from the Hope Service through Elliot's special school. and we had contact with a lady called Michelle. Michelle made time to talk to Elliot on a Wednesday morning between 11 and half past or quarter to 12. Elliot would have the phone and he would take this off himself and go and talk to Michelle in a different room. This half an hour or so would give me a little breathing space also. Come end of June time, Elliot started back to school one day a week and continued to talk to Michelle. I noticed then Elliot's behaviour had got really, really much better. Both of us, we could talk, we could cuddle, things that we couldn't have done before without it getting quite heated or aggressive. Elliot also, over the 6 weeks holiday, stopped urinating overnight. So that was much better. And he started to go out of the house. We did have to plan before we went out of the house. We had to know where we were going, how long we would be out, what we would be doing. He also needed me to let him know he had to wear a mask. He had to wash his hands before and after, and while we were out, use hand sanitizer. And he also had to realize there had to be distance between himself and others, which I know Elliot finds very hard. And when we went to see family and friends, Elliot normally had a cuddle, and he couldn't do that. Really, if it wasn't for the Hope's service, our life would have been so much different. We know we've got a long way to go at the present time, but to have Elliot back with his behaviour more stable and being able to talk together, and it's a much better family life. So we'd like to say thank you very much to the Hope Service and school nursing team for getting those involved. Thank you.
Many thanks to the Special Needs Continence Nursing Team for that presentation. It was most interesting. And now it's over to Forensics again, and they're going to talk to us about the co-production of their carers' website. So thank you very much.
Hello, my name's Jo, and I'm one half of the carer lead for Forensics here at Midlands Partnership Foundation Trust. I'd like to introduce Sue, who is a forensic carer who's helped us update the forensic website.
Hello everybody. As Jo has said, my name is Sue and I'm a forensic carer, and hoping to give you a bit of information as we go through these slides.
Thanks, Sue. So what information did we have from carers? And this is very much from a staff perspective. So we had three key ways that we shared information with carers. We had a carer's booklet, which people were given when anybody was admitted to any of our wards. Now I have to say, this isn't an image of the carer's booklet. This is just a general image of a booklet. The second way was we have a forensic website, and we had a whole section on carers and visitors, but it had been written by staff. We hadn't had any carers involved. And the third way was when each patient has a named nurse or care coordinator, and that person hopefully would link in with the carer or friend and family member. Again, Sue, I don't know if you want to say anything about any of that?
Well, I would just like to comment that I know, particularly with forensic units, that families don't always live conveniently close to the unit, for various reasons are not always able to go on site and to visit the site. So I think it's important that information is available in the variety of ways that Jo has explained, and that people take advantage of the information there and help to start familiarise themselves, which is quite important in the situation, particularly on the forensic unit.
Thanks for that, Sue. So you'll see now a blank screen with the carer experience of information on, and that's been done quite deliberately because what we heard from carers in the group of which Sue's been part of is that not all carers have access to that information for lots of different reasons, and we were a little bit naive in thinking that everybody could access the website and everybody could read the booklet and that everybody would be able to easily speak to the named key worker of their loved one. So Sue, if I can just hand over to you so that you can just share some of the feedback from yourself and some of the other carers in the group, that experience of getting hold of information.
Yes, as I've mentioned before, dealing with a forensic unit uses terminology and procedures that perhaps are not normal to most people. So getting your head around that and understanding what they all mean is quite crucial in getting families involved in the process and the service user's pathway through their treatment. I think a lot of carers really value at least one meeting with a real person, because it's far easier to ask the odd question then than perhaps try and hunt for something on a website where it's under a title you wouldn't imagine to find it. So that is really useful, but in conjunction with the other methods of information available, I think is a good combination.
So we'll move on to what we did. So we have set up these quarterly strategy meetings, which have been paused due to COVID, but we're hoping to restart again. And it was really important that we listened to the experiences and we reflected on our own assumptions and we actually collaborated and made the next steps. And for us, we were obviously focusing on the carer's website, although we have other things in hand and things that we're dealing with. But our focus was very much on the website. So that collaboration was very much about sitting down, looking at each section of the website and actually changing the voice from that of a, quite a corporate staff perspective to a carer perspective. And Sue, I think you'll agree, won't you, that a lot of the wording was very staff-focused and service user-focused rather than carer-focused?
Yes, it was. I think it's a real difficult shift because obviously staff are so focused on the service user, and rightly so, but when they have to think about the carer and what things are important to them and what they need to know, it's quite difficult for them to make that shift sometimes. So obviously, with a carer like myself who's been through the system to a certain degree and can give feedback, hopefully that enables the trust to make those changes for the better and also helps other people coming through that they find the information available is now better and more accessible for them.
Moving on to the outcomes, there were some good outcomes, but also there's some not bad outcomes. I've written good and bad on the slide, but some things that perhaps still need a little bit of work. We have updated the website and made some changes, and I've put the link if people want to go and look at it. We did share those changes with more carers at the carers quarterly meeting, and again there was some feedback there and some tweaks, but it has to be said, it's still really hard to find the forensic part of the carers on the website, on the trust website. And if you go to MPFT and try and put forensic or secure carers into the search engine, it doesn't come up. So unless you know where you're going, it's really hard to find. I don't know if you want to add anything else, Sue.
I think it's still a work in progress that we all agree is more or less a live document and will be added to as and when COVID and other things allow, and people have the chance to get back together and work on these things again. I think good progress has been made. I think the website is far better than it was, but obviously there's still work to be done, and work that we know we want to do and haven't had the chance to do up to now. So it is a live document, and hopefully people will revisit it and find the information that they're looking for.
That's a lot more positive than I said, so thank you. So next steps, we're going to make a plea that the forensic carers link is on the trust website, on the main carers page. I realise that, you know, all carers have needs, but I think the forensic carers, it's a very specific group of needs, and I think having that direct link on the carers when you go to the main carers page on the MPFT website would be really helpful. I think it'd be great to investigate ways for it to come up in a search when you go onto the MPFT website, and it's really important that we keep updating the website and collaborating, and also that we go wider than just a website. A website is one tool out of many.
I have commented on a couple of occasions, as you know, that I feel the forensic carers link should be more prominent and should be easily found. I think if you're coming into a situation where you're looking for information, you are not going to assume the information is there. And if it's not easily found, if it doesn't come up when you first click on something or look for it, then you're going to assume the information isn't there and not find it. And all the good work we've done in putting the information on there is lost. So I think the emphasis is getting the links right, so things come up when people start to search, and then hopefully they can move forward then in looking at things that will help them along their journey.
This is the place where we ask if anybody's got any questions or any queries, and I put my contact on there just in case anybody does want to get in contact with us. Again, Sue, I feel like I'm asking you at the end of every slide, is there anything you want to add? But for want of a better way to end, anything from you?
I just would like to mention the Forensic Carers Toolkit, which I think we'll probably be able to give the details and the link for that at some stage. But it's been put together to really help forensic carers navigate their way through the system. And I would recommend that staff have a look at it as well, particularly online, where there's some films embedded in the toolkit, which are quite short films, but make the pertinent point.
Thank you, Sue. I'll make sure that that's available for people.
Thank you very much to the forensics team for another interesting and informative presentation. Well, we've reached the end of day 4 of our celebration week. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. Thank you so much for everyone for taking part. It's really clear what a positive difference you are all making to the lives of service users and carers by engaging them in your work. The videos we've shared with you today will continue to be available via the link provided. Please feel free to share this link, as you wish, to encourage as many people as possible to take part in Celebration Week. Tomorrow will be our final day of presentations, My colleague Roz will be presenting the day with another packed agenda, including our prestigious Service User and Carer Awards. So thank you again for joining us today.